नमस्ते, माय नेम इज शुभम आलोक, वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल। टुडे इन दिस वीडियो आई वांट टू टॉक अबाउट वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ एस्ट्रोलॉजी, दैट इज कर्म एंड इट्स मैनिफेस्टेशन। वाराहमिहिर, वन ऑफ द मोस्ट सेलिब्रेटेड एस्ट्रोलॉजर्स, आचार्यज ऑफ द पास्ट, have clearly mentioned that Jyotish is called, astrology is called Jyotish, and it is called Jyotish because as light shows us what is kept in the dark, in the same way Jyotish also makes us know our past karmas and what is going to happen in our life as per those past karmas that we have committed in the previous lives. On the other hand, the sage Parasar in his Brihat Parasar Hora Shastra, in the first two chapters itself, have made it extremely clear that the planets are the incarnation of Sri Vishnu, and they give result to humans as per their karma, as per their deeds they have done in the previous lives. So the planets doesn't decide any result for us. They indicate what is in the store for this life for us based on the deeds that we have committed in previous lives. If you want to understand how karma works, if you want to understand how karma manifests, you should understand Ramayana. You should read Ramayana. That's why Ramayana is so highly celebrated, so spoken highly of. I will tell you three stories about Ramayana to give you an intro about the subject, and then we'll continue further. So once sage Narada, wanted to marry a lady. He went to Sri Vishnu and asked Sri Vishnu to give his face to Narada. Sri Vishnu said Kalyan. Sri Vishnu says two things, Kalyan and Tathastu. Tathastu means whatever you want, that will happen. Kalyan means whatever is best for you, that will happen. So getting this wish, Narada went to the marriage, and when the lady saw Narada, she started laughing. Narada was raised and furious about why this lady is not getting married to someone who is having face of Sri Vishnu. He saw his face in a mirror, in a pond, water. He saw his face in water. Generally, this is something which should not be done. If you see your face in water, you lose your respect. And wealth is what is told in Puranas, is what is told in Hindu Dharma. So rather that should not be done, but whatever. He saw his face in water and found his face to be turned into the face of a monkey. He goes to Sri Vishnu and curses him that I asked you a boon of giving me your face, but instead you give me the face of a monkey. And because of this reason, I was not able to get married. So you will lose your wife, and then you will have to take the help of monkeys to get your wife back. This is what manifested in Ramayana. Another story is when Dasharatha, the father of Rama, was hunting, he heard the chirping, he heard some sound. And he shot an arrow which killed Shravana Kumar. Shravana Kumar, the one who were taking his blind mother and father on a pilgrimage. Dasharatha knew that I did a mistake. And he told this complete story to the mother and father of Shravana Kumar, who in turn cursed them, cursed Dasharatha, that because of you, and because of your misunderstanding, we, the two blind people, are dying without our child. We will die. Eventually we will die. And our child will not be in front of us. You have taken away our child from us. So we curse you that you also will be separated from your child and will not be able to see him at your last moment. This is what happens. Rama is given Vanavas. Rama is given exile and Dasharatha dies alone without having his favorite child Rama anywhere. The third thing is the two gatekeepers of Vishnu once stopped a sage from entering, not being able to identify that he is a sage. And that sage in turn cursed them, cursed the gatekeepers of Vishnu to be born as demons in four lives. When they started asking for forgiveness, when they started asking for some mercy, the sage told them that in all those four lives, Sri Vishnu will come to rescue you, Sri Vishnu will come to kill you, and it will give you salvation from the body of the demon. And because of that curse, Ravana and Kumbhakarna, the two gatekeepers, were born, who eventually gets killed by Rama to get the salvation. If you read Ramayana further, you will find the story of Shabari, the story of Kevat, the story of Ahilya, how Ahilya turned into a stone because of some karma that she did or some misunderstanding that happened, and how Ram gives him salvation, the story of Jatayu, multiple things. So this is how the karma manifests in our lives. We do something in our previous life and we have to repay it in this particular life. This is how it works. And as Gita says, Gehna Karma No Gati, how karma works or how karma manifests is very difficult to be known. One cannot know it very easily, the manifestation of karma. And it is not, karma is not simple. You are going to meet someone and you should give them some money, or you know, some drunkard coming to you, you donating them money to alleviate yourself from karma. It doesn't work that simple. You read Ramayana and then you will understand how the karma really manifests. Your life conditions, your spouse, the nature of your spouse, and all the things and all the experiences that you are having in this life is because of past previous karma, is the simple statement of all the texts of Hindu Dharma. It is pretty simple. There's no confusion about this particular fact. So this needs to be understood. Generally, people come to me and they ask, sir, what bad karma I have done in this life to, you know, what bad karma I have done in this life to get this kind of bad result from that kind of bad result. No, we haven't done any bad karma in this particular life or any good karma in this particular life. We do the karmas, good or bad, whatever, in our previous lives, and then we have to get the result accordingly. There's a story. Once Shankaracharya was asking for alms, Bhiksha. And one lady gives him a gooseberry, amla. Now, because Lakshmi loves gooseberry, Lakshmi loves amla, Shankaracharya, that lady was very poor. So Shankaracharya went home and started praying to Mother Goddess Lakshmi, or started asking to, or rather say talking to Mother Goddess Lakshmi about the lady, and tells that she have given me gooseberry, she have given me amla as a donation. So how she can remain poor? Anyone who donates amla, anyone who donates gooseberry cannot remain poor. How she is remaining poor? How she is living poor? Devi Lakshmi told him that that lady haven't done any charity in her previous life. And if one doesn't do charity in his life, in this life, if one doesn't do charity, he doesn't get enough money in next life, of course, to perform charity. So Shankaracharya sought to help the lady. He created the Kanakadhara Stotram. He wrote the Kanakadhara Stotram. Next day, while asking for alms. He went to the lady, he went to her home, chanted the Kanakadhara Stotram, and coins or money started falling from the sky. This is the story of Kanakadhara Stotram. That using the Kanakadhara Stotram, Shankaracharya was able to make a rain of coins, a rain of wealth. So we should understand this. One who keeps on donating becomes rich in the next life. One who donates occasionally, only when some puja or yagya or anusthan is happening, they born in a poor family but eventually become rich. Those who donate a lot are born in a rich family, themselves remain rich. And those who never donate anything, either unoccasionally or occasionally, remain poor and pauper in the next life. So of course, no one have done any bad karma in this life to remain poor. But this is the result of the previous life. You know, you will generally see someone mistreating the lady, someone mistreating their wives, or, you know, like living a happy life. And we wonder why it is happening so. Because the manifestation of karma will not happen in this life, it will happen in the next life. You know what? The children who are dependent on you, like the children of your siblings, your students, etc., people dependent on you, if you mistreat them, if you don't behave well with them, then you remain without progeny in the next life. This is the karma vipak, or the manifestation of karma, rather. And the texts on karma vipak are very unauthentic. If you want to learn the real functioning of karma, real functioning of the real karma vipak, you should rather read Puranas and texts like Ramayana, which will better tell you how it works. That's why they are considered epics. Because through stories, they teach us these important lessons to improve our this life as well as the next life. And you know, if one have done a lot of bad karma, in that scenario, even remedies don't work on them. In that particular case, no matter what, how strong remedy one does, the result of it is postponed to the next life. Because in this life, the result they will get is of the previous lives. And in the previous life, they haven't done even that minimum amount of good karma to give them even 1% of the result of the remedy. So even the result of the remedy is also dependent on the karmas that you have done. But here, you should understand that karmas are of three categories. One is the daily karma that one does. Worshipping the God daily is known as nitya karma. It is like brushing your teeth. You are not doing anything special. So this doesn't count. You give money to your child. Oh, that doesn't count. That is not a donation. So that is a regular karma. It doesn't count. And after that, this comes the good karma and comes the bad karma, whatever. So my first point that have to be extremely clear in your heads is that karma is not very simple or very small. Everything. Your wife divorcing you, your wife having affairs, not getting a child, born in a poor family, not able to secure money, not able to save money, not able to get a job, miserable life. Everything is based on karma. On the other hand, having a good life, having a supportive spouse, having a good marital life, born in a rich family, having multiple resources, having loving parents, having many siblings, many children is also dependent on good karma. So it is not only negative. This is something that needs to be understood. Knowledge is neither negative nor positive. If I tell you that if you touch an electricity wire, you will get electrocuted and can also die, will you call me a negative person? I don't think so. This is knowledge that I am giving. When WHO, World Health Organization, was telling us how many people have died because of corona and how difficult the next wave of corona will be, were you telling them negative? I don't think so. Knowledge is neutral. We have to gain the knowledge so we can save ourselves from the negativity that can happen if we don't know it. Doing things unknowingly is a big problem. which cannot be overlooked. That is one point. The second point is, there is no specific, this is what we learn in parampara. I belong to a parampara which is at least 500 to 600 years old, right? And along with this, I have also learned in the Kerala system, as Kerala system of astrology as well, which is there since 4th century or the 5th century AD. So in the parampara also, and if you deeply study classics, specifically with reference to the shloka of Varahamihira that I have mentioned before, that birth horoscope, the shloka of Varahamihira in Parashar, that birth horoscope and the planet indicates the deeds that one have done in the past life and the results that one have to go through. And because the horoscope enlightens us about these topics, and we can know about these things only through the knowledge of astrology, it is called Jyotisha. Right? This is pretty clear. So make one thing extremely clear in your mind, that there is no specific combination or a specific technique that indicates karma. Everything in horoscope indicates karma. The planet in the seventh house indicates how your marital life will be. The seventh lord indicates how your wife will be. The Venus indicates what is the strata of society, or what is the status of woman in that strata of society where you are born. All these three things, your marital life experiences, as well as the nature of your wife, along with the strata of society in which you are born, it is all dependent on past life karma. What do you think? If your wife is fighting with you, is it not a past life karma? Or if your wife is short in height, is it not a past life karma? Or your wife is having some disease, is it not a past life karma? Everything that you go through is a past life karma. In the same way, every planetary combination and everything is a past life karma. Anything at all. Seventh lord in any house, any planet in seventh house, anything indicates a condition or a certain way of manifestation. And that manifestation and that condition is karma. But in this video, my prime topic is to give you a set of formulas that we apply in the parampara to pinpoint the major karmas, or say the most important karmas of one's life. This is what is taught in parampara. I'm not talking of from any book. This is what is taught in parampara. And parampara is a gist of whatever it is called. It is a concise version of the complete knowledge that is given in classics. Remember that parampara is not separate from the classic astrological knowledge. All these people who have written classics on astrology have been astrologers at a point of time. And Loma Samhita very beautifully describes it, that all the sages have understood astrology. They have practiced it and enriched it with their experience. And this particular thing, their understanding plus their enrichment with experience, they have taught to their students. And this is what have made the texts. And the same thing, passed down generation to generation, have made the parampara also. So the only difference between the text and the parampara is, parampara teaches you how to apply the principle, when to apply the principle, when not to apply the principle, and what is the limitation of the principle. That's what parampara teaches you. Parampara doesn't introduce to you a new technique, generally, though it does a few times, but not always. So now let's look at the major techniques, or the major advice, rather, the major advice that parampara have to give regarding karma and how to identify it through horoscopes. The first and the most important thing is a planetary combination. Karma manifests through planetary combinations. Try to understand this point. Planets are living beings. Rashi is a condition. And the house is a situation. So the seventh house is the situation where you want to get married. The Rashi in the seventh house is the conditions of marriage, that you have to follow this, you have to follow that. So suppose there is Leo in the seventh house. The condition of marriage is to be like a lion, be courageous, protective, etc. And planets are the living being, the humans. Because planets, if you have read about planets, they have their, you know, they have things very akin to planets. You know, sun is the king. King is a human. Sun indicates father. Father is a human. Right. So planet and the division of planets are generally based on the things that are humans. You know, the Rashis are animals. Only few Rashis are humans. So planets are humans. And the major, the first thing to see the karma is planetary conjunctions. A karma done from one human to another human. A karma between two humans is the major karma. The most major karma, the most important karma. Planetary conjunctions. Specifically, two planet combinations. So you have to find two planet combination in a horoscope. If there is no two planet combination, then you can take the three planet combination or the four planet combination in the horoscope. But in that scenario also, you have to choose the most strongest two planets and should see a connection with them. This point is, I think, extremely key. If there is no conjunction, then aspect should also be considered as a conjunction. Suppose say Mercury is aspecting Moon. So because Mercury is aspecting Moon, it can be taken as a Moon-Mercury conjunction. That is also the, this is what Parampara teaches. Conjunction is equal to aspect, aspect is equal to conjunction. This is what Parampara teaches. Now you get the answer why Varahamihir have mentioned Moon aspecting Sun, Mercury aspecting Sun and Venus aspecting Sun. These combinations Varahamihir have mentioned. What happens when Venus aspects the Sun or Mercury aspects the Sun? And you read any commentator of Brihadjatak, they will always write this can never happen. Varahamihir have written something absurd. This cannot happen. People have tried to explain it using multiple ways. But the parampara is pretty simple. Aspect is equal to conjunction. Conjunction is equal to aspect. The results are interchangeable. So Varahamihir have written it this particular way. So if anyone outside the parampara reads it, it's a problem. But if you have the support of parampara and have the proper guru to guide you, you always have the answer. However, coming back to my point. So you have to get a two planet combination. That two planet combination, if it is in Kendra, 1, 4, 7, 10, it is first preferred. Second preference is combinations in Panavara in the second house, fifth house, eighth house, and 11th house. And the third preference is planets in Apoplima in the third house, sixth house, ninth house, and 12th house. So if there is a two planet combination in Kendra, go with it. If not, then check the second, fifth, eighth, and 11th house. If not there also, then give preference to third house, sixth house, ninth house, and 12th house. Go in this particular order. If there are more than one two planet combination in the Kendra, in that scenario, what to do? Take the stronger combination. For an example, exalted Saturn conjoined with Venus versus Moon in Gemini conjoined with Mars. Now, because in the exalted Saturn plus Venus combination, Saturn is exalted and Venus is an own Rashi, that have to be given preference over Mars and Moon in Gemini, right? So based on that, the karma have to be decided. And what karma one have done and how it will manifest is decided based on the common factors between the planet. The common factors between the planet. Now take this Sun Saturn, now take this Saturn Venus combination from our example. What is common between Saturn and Venus? They both are Asura planets. Sura planets are Sun, Mars, Moon, Jupiter. Asura planets are Mercury, Saturn, and Venus. So when they are in conjunction, it is an Asura combination. It is a combination of two Asuras, two demons. Asura means what? Sura is the one who is following the rules and regulations, following the dharma. Asura is the one who is not following the dharma, who is going against the dharma. So dharma tells you that you go to the home of the lady, talk to their parents, and then get married. What Asura will do? Asura will flee away with the lady. Like Ravan in Ramayana. He kidnaps Sita. That is adharma. That is what demons are supposed to do. Gods are not supposed to do that. Rama went to the marriage ceremony of Sita, broke the bow and took her. Authorized. Authoritatively. By the rules and regulations. This is what the Suras do. So it indicates the Asura pravritti or, you know, not following the dharma. This is the karma that have happened in the horoscope. Now, in which matters the person haven't followed the dharma? So in this chart, check which houses are lorded by Saturn, which houses are lorded by Venus, which houses get the aspect of Saturn, and which houses get the aspect of Venus. That will tell you that this break of dharma happened in these matters. So suppose this combination is happening in the seventh house. This break of dharma happened in marriage. What will be the result? If you break the dharma in marriage, if you kidnap a lady for marriage, what happens? You have to see the death of your subordinates, like Ravan have to see his child dies in front of him. This is not a good thing that children are dying in front of fathers. But this is what he has seen. This is a bad karma of doing something to a woman against her will. Should not be done. This is how it has to be understood. I will come to every combination one by one. Sun and moon combination, both of them are kings. So it indicates misuse of power. Sun and Mars, both of them are Kshatriyas. It indicates breaking a law because there is no one who can stop you. Sun and Mercury, they both are birds. That indicates running away from responsibility. Which responsibility? Check the houses lorded by Sun and Mercury and houses aspected by Sun. Sun and Jupiter, they both are sattvic in tendency. The karma is that the person have become so much sattvic that he haven't given any importance to the desires of family. Sattvic person will generally will not be interested in saving money or, you know, like saving money or purchasing things or etc. things like this. And this can actually cause displeasure to family members. Until and unless you are right, it is okay. But when you see, because you are a sattvic person, you don't believe in spending money. That doesn't mean you can stop your wife from following the dharma of being wife. And the dharma of being wife also means wife getting, you know, ready in a very beautiful way. And to get ready, maybe she wants something. Maybe a suit or a sari or some jewelry. And you being a sattvic person refuse to spend money there. And tells to only spend money in puja part, etc. Only in worship, etc. then this is something bad that you have done against your wife. That will become a problem. Okay. Sun and Venus is the story of the king and the beautiful lady. The sun, king getting attracted to Venus, the beautiful lady, and in this way cheating his original wife, Moon. Sun and Saturn combination indicates the rise of democracy, an age-old tradition of Sun being challenged by Saturn, an age-old tradition being broken because of the rise of new powers. So Sun and Saturn indicates not following the order of the superior one. Moon and Mars combination indicate the fight between Sattva Guna and Sattvic Guna. Sattvic Guna, what is Sattvic and what is Sattva? To fight for your homeland and protect it is Sattva. That commander-in-chief or army people do. Sattvic is not killing even an ant. Having pure code and conduct. What is important? Both have their own places, but when you mix it, when you become sattvic to enemies and so sattva towards your family members, that's the problem that Mars and Moon causes. Not changing from sattvic to sattva, from protection to non-violence at the right time creates the Moon-Mars disruption. Moon and Mercury indicates running away from responsibilities. Moon and Jupiter indicates Guru Droha, the cheating your Guru. That is a very heinous crime. In Guru Gita, Lord Shiva have clearly told that if you make any mistake to God, your Guru can save you. But if you do any mistake towards your Guru, even I am, that means even Shiva is not able to save such a person. Moon and Venus is the karma of jealousy, because one is the queen, Moon, and Venus is the beautiful lady. It is jealousy, what people do in revenge, and the repercussions of it. It is like, you know, like I suppose someone gets jealous from one lady, gets jealous from another lady and burns her clothes, so that she is not able to wear it now. And it is an important function. So she have to go normal, in normal dresses, and then people will laugh on her, talk badly. This will cause her same and grief at the same point of time. That is what Moon Venus creates. Moon and Saturn is not following the Rutucharya, not following the Muhurta. You don't copulate on the days of Parva. You don't copulate before going to worship. This is code of conduct of Kal, Ritucharya, or say Kal. This is the following of the Kali Chakra. If you don't follow this, it results in Moon-Saturn combination, which gives Kali Chakra related problem. What is Kali Chakra related problem? Not being able to follow things on time. So what will happen in this? Because you were not in tune with time in the previous life. What happens in this life? Things signified by houses ruled by Moon and Sun doesn't come to you at the right time. For example, suppose in this Moon-Saturn combination, Moon is the Lord of the fifth house. Or Saturn is the Lord of the fifth house, or the combination is in the fifth house. You will have a child, but at the age of 60 years. Now, will you be able to meet the requirements of the child, or will you be able to enjoy the happiness with child when you are 60? If you are 60 and your child is 4 years of age, do you think that you will be able to go out with him and have some fun in the park? I don't think so. Though still you can go, but that's a difficult karma. things are not coming at the right time. This is what it indicates. So how it manifests, how this combination will manifest, you have to decide yours. Or that's not what I am teaching people. How it will manifest in this particular life, this I am not teaching people. If needed, if people drop comment that they also want this particular section, maybe in near future I will make a video on. Right now we are not covering this topic. Mars and Mercury combination indicates humiliation, humiliating someone who is rather completely dependent on you. Humiliating someone dependent on you, humiliating someone completely surrendered to you is the problem created by Mars Mercury combination. Mars Jupiter combination indicates problem of giving power to someone who is unworthy of it and the person that misusing the power. Mars and Venus indicates extreme passion and crimes committed in extreme passion. Now, in this combination, suppose Mars or Venus is the fourth lord, then person drove a vehicle in extreme passion and hit someone. That type of karma indicates. Mars and Saturn combination indicates a lot of tamas, a lot of negative tendencies, a lot of negativity. It also indicates cursing, by the way. Cursing everyone unnecessarily and create spoiling their mood. It is also a bad karma. Mercury and Jupiter indicates being too jealous or speaking foul of others. That is also a very bad karma. If you have two standards, ask something, say something else on the mouth and say something else in the back, it is also a bad karma. And this backbiting results in people having pain in their bones. That is a problem. Mercury and Venus combination indicates a lot of ambition. And to fulfill this ambition, crushing other person's desires combination is the karma indicated by Mercury and Venus. Mercury and Saturn indicates not taking responsibilities of even the basic things that are expected from you. For an example, suppose you are a child of your parents. Now, as a child, you are supposed to at least give happiness to your parents. Don't give them money. Don't make them live with you. Give nothing, but at least give them happiness. When you are even not able to give that, it is a Mars Saturn combination. Jupiter and Venus indicates taking competition or being competitive to person who is superior to you in knowledge and experience. Jupiter and Saturn indicates not doing the minimum necessity that is needed to be done. Regarding what? Regarding the houses ruled by Jupiter and Saturn, and regarding the significations of the houses ruled by Jupiter and Saturn. Venus and Saturn indicates a combination where when things come easily to the person, he don't enjoy it and keeps yearning for the things which are not in his fate. This is because of a combination. This is because of a type of karma where the person haven't gave any importance to his wife, but rather was busy making love to or being in relationship with some other lady who is not his spouse. Sun or moon conjoined with Rahu indicates a lot of sattvic energy and its misuse, whereas sun or moon conjoined with Ketu indicates the person being self-destructive to destroy his enemy. Mars and Rahu indicates a karma where the person have made other person a vehicle, make other person a protagonist to get his karma fulfilled. Mars and Rahu is an astra combination. Astra is a weapon that you throw at your enemies. So Mars and Rahu indicates that this person motivated some other person to do something that he wanted to do but never did it. So, you know, so basically what you are committing a bad karma through someone else, making him your messenger or worker, and unnecessarily throwing him into the trap of that karma. Mars and Ketu indicates problem related to short tempers, problem related to being short tempered and misbehaving, or, you know, beating people because of that, and bad karmas that comes out. Mercury and Rahu combination indicates a lot of Rahuvian tendencies, and Mercury and Ketu indicates lack of Ketu tendency. Whereas Jupiter and Rahu indicates lack of Rahu's tendency, and Jupiter and Ketu indicate lack of Ketu's tendency. Now mind it here, Jupiter and Rahu is traditionally known as Guru Chandala Yoga. But Parampara teaches us that in Jupiter and Rahu combination, there is a lack of Rahu energy. This is something very exceptional. Right? I think in my career of 11 years as a practicing astrologer, I have never told anyone that you have a Guru Chandala Yoga in your horoscope, right? Because Parampara doesn't teach us this way. Now, about Rahu and Ketu, you know, the too much of Rahu energy or the lack of Rahu energy, or rather say too much of Ketu energy and the lack of Ketu energy. What happens with it? Rahu and Ketu are already demons. And I have already explained the demonic tendency. Now the thing above it is Rahu and Ketu are very much dedicated to their parents and very much dedicated to their objective. The demon Swarbhanu, which later became Rahu and Ketu, wanted to drink the nectar. He was in the team of the demons. Vishnu took the avatar of Mohini and started distributing nectar, where she was not giving it to demons and was giving it to gods. Mohini was so beautiful, so enchanting, that even Shiva fall under the trap of Maya, looks at Mohini and gets ejaculated. But Rahu and Ketu were the only one in the complete army who found that this Mohini is Sri Vishnu and we should not be falling in the trap. So this focus and devotion to parents, which Rahu and Ketu have always showed, or the demon Swarbhanu have always showed to his mother, is unparalleled. So devotion to parents and being focused on the aim is their good tendencies. Whereas being an Asura, being a demon, is the negative tendency. And how being a demon works negatively, that the person breaks the dharma, doesn't follow the dharma. That is a pathetic problem. That's a major problem. I think this point is clear. Venus and Rahu, people understand that it indicates a lot of sexuality. But according to my experience, Venus and Rahu combination, you will find, are the ones who will not be, for them sexuality is a routine. The karma for Venus and Rahu is they, you know, the problem is they are very much into routine. This is the major problem with Venus Rahu combination. They are very much in routine, and because they follow a lot of routine, they don't do unexpected or surprising things, which actually causes a type of dissatisfaction to the people around you, and turns into a negative karma. For an example, like Deepavali is coming close, and we are supposed to gift things to our near and dear ones in Deepavali. Now, if we don't do that, we will break the expectations of many people around us. And this breaking of expectation is not a good karma. That is also bad. I'm not going too in depth into it about what type of karma it is, what are the examples, etc. For example, take the example of Saturn and his wife. Saturn was busy doing puja, and his wife wanted to have a sexual relationship with Saturn. Now his wife kept on waiting for 2 days, but Saturn was still busy in puja even after the 2 days. Third day when the Saturn came, his wife have lost the moon. And his wife cursed him that you were not able to see me when I wanted to have a sexual copulation. Now, whomever person you see, he will be turned into ashes. He will destroy. He will get destroyed. So from that day onwards, Saturn looks downwards. So he's not, you know, he's not going to confront anyone or face anyone. Now, what is the mistake of Saturn? He was doing puja. He was worshipping. Then what is the mistake of his wife? She was going, she was wanting to have a copulation. That is pretty straightforward. The thing is, the breakage of expectation. Not paying any heed to the desires of wife. A husband should always fulfill the desire of her spouse. And the spouse and the wife should also always fulfill the desire of their spouse. So if somehow you are too much in routine or you are too much in discipline that you are not fulfilling the expectations of your spouse even occasionally, it's a problem. Of course, right? This is what I want to make clear right here. Venus and Ketu indicates a married ascetic. So person is generally ascetic, he has ascetic tendencies, etc. But because of the peer pressure of mother, family, etc., they get married. Now in this scenario, what happened? The person got married because he followed his dharma of giving happiness to their parents. And because parents told to get married, he got married. But he have an ascetic tendencies, and because he have an ascetic tendencies, he or she will not play the role of the spouse. So that will be bad to the spouse in reality. Whereas the person himself never wanted to get married, but to keep the parents happy, he did it. The repercussions of it have to be faced. Right? And that is what Venus Ketu combination. Saturn Rahu combination indicates a boon. I'm pretty sure that you have heard story of a king who took the boon of that whatever he will touch will turn into gold. He was very happy. He kept on doing everything. Everything was turning into gold. He was becoming day by day very rich. Then his daughters came to him. Two daughters were there. He touched one of them, hugged his daughter. She turned into gold. Now he was very sad. Because of this boon, he cannot even hug his daughter. He cannot even touch his spouse. Cannot even touch his child. So the boon actually became a bane. That is what happens with Saturn Rahu. It is an alchemist combination. They can turn everything into gold. But do we really want everything to be turned into gold? Everything is beautiful. Do you really want everything to be beautiful? As you use anything, there will be normal wear and tear and change over time. Saturn Rahu combination indicates no change at all. That's a big problem. The level of understanding on the day one is same. On day 100 also. Evolving with time is lacking in Saturn Rahu combination. That is also a bad karma. Saturn and Ketu is to be slaughtered combination. Saturn and Ketu is pretty simple. You take a goat, keep it in home, give him food, and one day you got to kill him, sacrifice him to eat the meat, to eat the bones and flesh of the goat. How good it is. He was in the wilderness. Maybe he was not healthy. He was starved or anything. But who give you this power to take him to home, cage him, give him food, make him fed, and then kill him? So this is the Saturn kick. How to use it, how to interpret it, how it will manifest. Astrologers, my astrologer friends, have to use their imagination, their logical mind, and other combinations. The house is owned by these planets, and the house is getting affected by these planets, and that will give you the answer. This is how you are supposed to use it. In astrology, nothing is monotonous. Nothing is replicable. No two people are same. I am Aquarius Lagna. You can also be Aquarius Lagna. I have Saturn in ascendant. Maybe you also have Saturn in ascendant. You find 10 people Aquarius Lagna with Saturn in ascendant and match their face. None of their face will meet with my face. My face is extremely different. Out of this huge population in the world, my face is only my face. Your face is only your face. Why it is not repeating? So astrology is repetitive only 50%. 50% it is dynamic, 50% it is repetitive. So what is repetitive? I have told you. The other things on how it will manifest in this life, how it will work, what will happen is dynamic. That based on other planetary combinations, etc., which you as an astrologer, as a practitioner, have to find yourself. And if you are not an astrologer, you better know what needs to be done. Secondarily, the second technique that I will want to discuss about today is that Rashi or the signs indicates a heap of karma. Rashi just means that. Rashi means quantity. If I have to ask in Sanskrit about how much money you have or how much money he have donated, I will ask it as kitni dhan rashi mili. Kitni dhan rashi mili. So rashi is the quantity. So this is one major thing that I always talk about. You read the biography of Marilyn Monroe and you read the biography of Henry Ford, you will find a difference. Suppose there are 5 chapters in the biography of Monroe. In the 5 chapters, 3 chapters will discuss her marriage. In the horoscope of J.R.D. Tata or in the biography of J.R.D. Tata, out of the 5 chapters, 3 chapters will discuss about his profession and dedication to profession, money making skills, leadership, etc. What is the difference? The strength of planets. Marilyn Monroe have a exalted 7th lord. That means prominent marriage karma. 7th lord is exalted, marriage karma is prominent. 10th lord is exalted, profession karma is prominent. So make a list of planets as per their strength. If a biography is written on you, maximum pages are taken by the planet who is maximum powerful. And lesser number of pages are taken by the planets who are less powerful. This is a very important fundamental. No two planets will have the same condition. Few planets will be strong, few planets will be weak. And that actually decides what is happening in life. Strong seventh lords indicate a lot of marriage karma, a lot of upheavals, because there have to be more pages in the biography. Normal seventh lord is normal. Weak seventh lord is almost no pages. Loved a lady, was not able to marry him, then never got married again. Simple case. So this also indicates the karmas that one have to do. The planet and the strengths. You have to notice every planet and the strengths and the houses they own. According to the strength of the planet. According to the strength of the planet. The importance of that particular house in the complete life of the person either increases or decreases. So you have to judge it accordingly. This is the second technique from the parampara. The third technique is this is very, very basic. This is reading a planet. Suppose the seventh lord. It is situated in the fourth house. Fourth house indicates mother, property, vehicle, etc. Now, the karma of marriage that is indicated by the seventh lord have to manifest through the fourth house. The karma of marriage have to manifest through happiness, mother, property, vehicle. So it may indicate that in marriage there is a lot of happiness or a lack of happiness. There are fights because of vehicle, or there is happiness of vehicle, blessing of vehicle after marriage. Mother will play a very crucial role in marriage, will have very strong karma related to marriage because the seventh lord is of the fourth house. So this is very crucial. The karma manifestation happens based on the different houses where the house lord goes and the different planets that he conjoins. Another example. If the seventh lord is in the eighth house, the karma of marriage manifests through death, shock, misfortune, unexpected events, etc. This is how the karma of marriage manifests through. Now, if this seventh lord in eighth house is further conjoined with Saturn, then this karma of death, shock, misfortune, or unexpected events in marriage will manifest through beggars, servants, near dustbins, through iron and leather objects, etc. I actually have a client who have his seventh lord in eighth house. I think with Mars also. And because of it, he had a girlfriend from foreign lands. And just a few days after breakup, she met with an accident, a car accident, and she died. This was a major karma. I'm pretty sure that it must have shook him. He must have changed multiple of his concepts at various levels. So that is the seventh lord in eighth house. The karma of marriage, or the lessons in marriage, the lessons of the soul for this life regarding marriage have to manifest through the eighth house. And then see the aspects and conjunctions over it that will further tell it why it was in car accident only. Because of, I think because of Mars. Because Mars is there, some blast also have to be included. So the manifestation of karma basically happens this. Because life to life. The soul, when it will be perfect, it will meet in the supreme soul, the Paramatman. When it is perfect. Now the soul is not perfect at all. So soul perfects himself. Life by life. Or rather say manas. Soul doesn't get any experience at all. But the astral body, rather. Or if you go to the yogic divisions, manachitta, ahankara, multiple things are there. So apart from soul, there is a consciousness which goes life through life, collect the experiences and manifested in the next life. Your psychological fears, your weaknesses by birth are actually the result of those shocking and horrible experiences that you have gone through in the past. Now in this life, that astral body, that body who have took the information about the experiences will try to give you skills or try to give lack of skills which are related to those incidents to further enrich the experience. For an example, suppose someone witnesses a fire accident in previous life. Now in this life, either he will not be afraid of fire or he will be highly afraid. This thing will be there in that part of body, in that part of soul, or in that seat of being which collects the experiences. That's why life by life, practice by practice. That's why it is told in spirituality that you do some mantras in this life, that mantras, that chanting gets stored, then you die. And the next life, when you start doing mantras again, you get access to that storage of your mantra chanting from the previous life. And it starts manifesting in this particular life. This is what happens to people. This is this Ramakrishna tells the story that there was a tantric doing Kali Puja in the jungle and a tiger came and ate him. There was another person on the tree. He saw everything. After the tiger was gone, he sat on the asan and did the mantra of Kali 2-3 times. Kali came in front of him and Kali told, ask whatever you want to ask. He says that, mother, I want a simple answer. This person was doing your mantra since very long. You haven't came to him. I have just came. And you came in front of me. What is this? You please explain me. Kali tells him that you did my mantra. You are doing my mantra since last 3 lives. That's why I am in front of you. He have just started. He need few more lives. So there is something inside that collects the experience, makes your being accordingly. So the psychological fears, a particular type of mindset, and these things are because of that. This needs to be understood also. I will give 1-2 more points. The stronger the Lord of Lagna is, heavier is the bond of karma that one has to go through. Same is applicable to planets in Lagna. Lagna Lord strong. Strong planets in Lagna indicate heavy bond of karma, a lot of karma to go through. Weak Lagna Lord, weaker planets in Lagna indicate very few karmas. And understand one point. You cannot live even a moment more once your karma is finished. You know, even avatars, even incarnations of God die and they always tell a simple thing that, oh God, my karma is fulfilled. Now I have to die. I cannot live more than my karma. So this is also the rule for longevity. Stronger the Lagna Lord, more the number of karma, longer the life. Weaker the Lagna Lord or planet in Lagna, lesser the number of karma, shorter the life. Very simple. Specifically remember, and I want to specifically clarify this, which is the house related to karma? 10th house. Relates to karma. The signification of the 10th house is karma. So one should specifically check the 10th house, the 10th lord, the planets in the 10th house to see the major karmas that one have. Rabindranath Tagore had a lot of karma. He did a lot of karma. He lived a life. He lived a long life. He did a lot of karma. But the major karma was related to poetry and education. Raja Ram Mohan Roy did a lot of karma. But the major karma was related to something. Mahatma Gandhi did a lot of karma, but the major karma was related to partition of India or freeing India from the clutches of Britishers. So everyone does a lot of karma, but there are some major karmas for which one is known for. That is indicated by the 10th Lord. Stronger the 10th Lord, bigger the mission. Bigger the karma that one have do in this life. Weaker the 10th Lord, weaker the karma. You check the chart of Mahatma Gandhi, 10th Lord in 10th house with Rahu. Rahu indicates foreigners. The major karma is freeing the motherland from the clutches of foreigners. And 10th Lord in 10th house was a very strong combination. He had a big, huge karma to do. Not all of us have that huge karma. Strength of the planets in the 10th house or the 10th lord, the magnanimity of the karma and combinations, etc., decide what type of karma one have to do or one have to go through. This is a few snippets of what Parampara teaches or rather advises on how to see karma through astrology. And as I have told in the starting also, it is very essential or rather which is the prime motive of astrology to guide us on what is our karmas and how it will manifest in this particular life. And this is the particular reason it is known as Jyotisha. Thank you for watching the video. Namaskar.